The situation is developing so rapidly, I'm sure you're going to be amazed at this video. So hang on, hang on. People here are losing their nerves because they know something big is coming. Something big is coming. And now, so we will just jump right in with both feet here. But first we pause a little bit and recognize we listen to this in the mood of repentance. Meaning, we know that mortal mind is false, and we know that eternal mind is true. And we know the only problem we have is a continuity problem. We can evaporate this problem if we use the right tactics, the right spiritual tactics, and we know what those tactics are. So we listen in the mood of repentance, knowing that mortal mind is only a pretense of eternal mind pretending to be mortal, and therefore there isn't any actual mortal mind caused of it. It's actually just a pretending of eternal mind, just because it wanted to try to be greater than God. Actually, the spirit wanted to be greater than God, that's why. And there's a way just to awaken and realize, hey, I am eternal mind. I always have been. I never strayed from it, really. It's still here. So now, today I had several extraordinary experiences. The most extraordinary one we will get into right now, because I know everybody wants to, you know, make the most of the time here. Okay. Let me grab something here. Oh, it's so heavy I can hardly do 10 reps. Oh my God. Good grief. This, I weighed this, and it weighs 10 pounds. It's bigger by quite a bit, bigger than a football, and it is 10 pounds. It is just the most. And I said, what in the world is this? I just stepped out of my vehicle, and this was there on the ground. Oh, gosh. And I actually had asked God, I said, God, I need you to send me a calling card. Send me a calling card today. I have to have a calling card. Let me know. Let me know. So I step out of my vehicle, and there's this thing lying on the ground. And immediately I went over to it, and I said, I've never seen anything like this. What is this? I asked somebody, do you know what this is? No idea. What the heck is this? It's like from some other world. Well, I got some sap on my fingers from this. I Googled it. World's heaviest pine cone. World's biggest pine cone. It looks like a pine cone in some way. You know, it really does. But I said, how can this be a pine cone? This is crazy. Well, I found out what it is. I found a picture on Google. I said, there it is. There it is. Okay. So I started in researching this. And what I found out was just absolutely amazing. Absolutely amazing. First of all, what is this pine cone doing, you know, right by my vehicle? What is this? Why? You know, this is such a complete anomaly that it's absolutely extraordinary on that account alone. This is a pine cone from the Bunya pine tree. And I will read a little bit of this to you, because it gets very, very interesting, fascinating. It's a large evergreen coniferous tree in the plant family, blah, blah, blah. It is found naturally in southeast Queensland, Australia. Southeast Queensland, Australia, and two small disjunct populations in northeastern Queensland World Heritage listed wet tropics. There are many fine old planted specimens in New South Wales and around the Perth, Western Australia metropolitan area. They can grow up to 30 to 45 meters. Okay, distribution. They talk about the distribution. Now, it's only, you know, it's just, there's a few areas in this one Queensland area where it's naturally grows. It's wet tropic. Okay. The cones, the 20 to 35 in diameter, opened by a large bird such as cockatoos, are disintegrate and mature to release large seeds or nuts. Uh, Okay, let me get cultural significance. This is where we get into what is the significance of finding something like this. I immediately recognize this is very, very significant. This is such an anomaly, such a bizarre anomaly. Never seen anything like it. I just really didn't know it. What could this be? I thought it was a fruit, some kind of fruit, but no. It's this massive pine cone. And why is it here? I mean, we not have these trees here in California. I imagine maybe someone must have planted one somewhere. and somehow it ended up by my vehicle, this pine cone. But this, the cultural significance of this, which is so extraordinary, so extraordinary. Each segment of the pine cone has a nut in it, and the kernel is like similar to a chestnut. They talk about bunion festivals, bunya festivals. Okay, these large festival harvests vary between two and 7 years. When the fruit is ripe, the people of the region would set aside differences, gather in the Bunya Mountains, the Bunya Mountains, to feast on the kernel. So this pine cone was the center of Aboriginal festival, huge festivals actually. As the fruit ripened, locals who were bound by custodial obligations and rights, listen to this, sent out messengers to invite people from hundreds of kilometers away to meet at specific sites. The meetings involved ceremonies, dispute settlements and fights, marriage arrangements, and the trading of goods. The Aborigines' fierce protection of the trees and recognition of the value of the timber led to colonial authorities prohibiting settlers from cutting trees in 1842. The resource was too valuable, and the Aborigines were driven out of the forest along with the ability to run the festivals. The forests were felled for timber and cleared to make way for cultivation. In what was probably Australia's largest indigenous event, get this, in what was probably Australia's largest indigenous event, diverse tribes, up to thousands of people, once traveled great distances from as far as Charleville, Dubbo, Bundaberg, and Grafton to the gatherings. They stayed for months to celebrate and feast on the Bunya nut. They stayed for months to feast on the Bunya. Gatherings were an armistice, accompanied by much trade exchange and discussions and negotiations over marriage and regional issues. Due to the sacred status of the Bunya, some tribes would not camp amongst those trees, and in some regions, the tree was never to be cut. Indigenous groups have continued cultural and spiritual connection to the Bunya Mountains this day. This is just absolutely astonishing. Who would have ever thought that we would come across this information? The largest indigenous gatherings in the history of Australia were to come and eat the nuts of this pine cone. And it's considered a sacred tree. And this is a place where everyone would put aside their differences. And there'd be armistices. All the various troubles, you know. Armistice, meaning a temporary peace accord where everyone gets along. They talk out their differences. They resolve their differences. It was a means of doing this. And the bunya fruit ripened every 2 to 7 years. It's erratic. It's erratic. It doesn't happen all the time. You can't predict it, actually. So, first, about a week and a half ago or so, someone gives me this silk drawing, a painting on silk from India with this huge elephant, and on top it says the arrival of the Maharaj, the Maharaj arriving, the great king is on his way, is about to arrive at this great ceremony, okay? And I was like, wow, here's a calling card from the divine. Because I've been saying that there's going to be some great gatherings, event, the great spiritual events take place now. to counterbalance the very negative stuff that's going on in the world. We'll get to that. So I thought, wow, and then so many other signs are arising right now. So many signs are arising that says this is on. This is on now. And so then what happens today? What happens today? Oh, God, I'm going to tip over trying to lift this thing up. Oh, my gosh. This absolutely incredible pine cone. Okay. This absolutely incredible pine cone is right there, right in front of me as I get out of my vehicle. Okay, it weighs almost as much as a watermelon. I'm telling you, it does. You want to get the weight of it? It's a water 10 pounds, 10 pounds. And it's just massive and solid. It's just extraordinary. And this happens to be what brings together people from great distances, setting aside all their differences for the purpose of getting together for something very important, and they happen to be feasting on the nuts of this. But so it served a very, very, very important, sacred purpose for the indigenous people. Okay. So, this is another calling card that says there's about to be at least a gathering taking place. It's erratic. You don't know what's going to happen, but this showing it's ready. It's ready. You see? The fruit is ready. The fruit is ready, which means that people will actually come these days from all over the world and maybe stay for months. So, just like it says the Aborigines, they stayed for months. You know, can't be this better than anyone could make up, right? People saying, well, just making that. This is something beyond anything that anyone can make up. Again, I have had no clue that anything like this ever existed. I was completely puzzled. I didn't know what it was. At first, I thought it was fake. I said, no, someone must have made this. Nothing could be like this. It's so different. It's amazing. And then, you know, the Google on this information, finding the picture and then Googling it, is just, here it is. Here it is. So if this doesn't blow your mind, nothing does. If this doesn't, you know, produce a wow, you know, I don't know what does. Now, it gets better. It gets better. Driving along today on this insanely balmy, beautiful California day. Again, the weather is just utterly ridiculously nice. It was windy, but nice, warm, balmy wind today. Warm, just amazing. Crystal clear, like an early autumn day, which is basically what it is. And welcome to September 1st, congratulations. And I looked out at everything, and I got this sort of recognition and realization of what the great teachers have been talking about. I've been working on some graphics of Ramana Maharshi and putting some of his quotes to it, and he says something like, you know, God, the light of God, the light is, it shines as everything but remains as it is. It shines as everything but remains exactly as it is. Or another way, it shines as everything but remains nothing. Nothing in particular. And I somehow began to realize this. Understood what was being said, and that there's a way we can look at the world where everything appears delightful to us and beautiful and so beautiful and delightful because we always look out from within. How we feel within is how we look out and see. It's like we're wearing glasses, and depending on what those glasses are like, that's how we will experience the world. And if we experience it as this, everything that we're seeing is so beautiful. It's God shining as all of this, and yet it doesn't change. It makes no impression or change upon God at all. God still remains as nothing. So the feeling is a bliss, and yet you're delighting in everything that's arising in bliss. It's the shining of God also. So God shines as everything but remains as nothing. And no matter what appearances arise, no impression is made upon God. The I, what we call I, is really our attempt to make an impression upon God. To make an impression upon God. And no impression is happening. So we can change our perception, our feeling, to one of God. If we view everything from the standpoint of God, we realize everything looks absolutely stunning, delightful. Everything is delightful because it's not changing how we feel at all, fundamentally. And yet we're still delighting in the diversity of it all. So I got an impression, so to speak, or I got a feeling of that a little bit. I said, wow, this is a little taste of it. You know, it's very, very subtle, but it's dawning upon me. I understood for a moment, oh, this is what they're talking about. This is what they're talking about. So and it's our desire to make an impression upon God that veils this feeling of God, which is, again, shining as everything but remaining as nothing. Or, you know, shining as all qualities and yet not taking on any of these qualities. See, not being affected by any of these qualities at all. And yet shining as all these qualities. So nothing impresses God and says, this has changed you. You know, no, God remains this like nothingness, no thing in particularness, this perfect impartiality-ness. And we can view everything this way, actually. So I'm tuning in. And this is dawning upon me. And meanwhile, there's all sorts of turmoil, very nasty turmoil going on. I'm stopped watching the news. I made a decision, start dieting, stop watching the news. It just, you know, August 30th, I made a decision. Okay, it's go time. And I was able to just flick the switch because of, what's that? Strange creature. Was pretty much able to flick a switch because I've been working every single day for so long, you know. So it was I could make a decision and say, that's it. No more fooling around. It's go time. And that's it. I stopped watching the news, paying attention. There's no more politics here. Okay, in the videos, at least as far as we go forward right now, I'm not watching the news. I don't know what's going on in the news. I don't care what's going on in the news. I already know there's a terrible storm going to hit us. And in the dream, it was a storm in the desert. You might call it desert storm, a storm in the desert. It could mean a terrible war. But the purpose of it is to make an impression upon God. I realize that what we're trying to do with this world is make an impression upon God, saying, God, something here is going to tint what you are, as it were, make an impression upon you, and it's going to change your impartiality, it's going to change your nothingness. And this is the belief in the I. The I, we believe, is something that can stamp God with and leave an impression, a lasting impression on God. And this is not true. It's like when you're viewing reality, everything as God, that's our natural condition. This is a very strange creature making all these noises. that it's like everything is being experienced in its qualities and everything, but there's no lastingness. It's always fresh. It's always fresh. It's always fresh. And it doesn't taint or precondition God at all. God maintains this absolute freshness. You see, so it's this is the experiencing. I'm getting a feel for this now. I said that eternal life is a feeling. Eternal life is a feeling. You get a feel for it. It's not an intellectual, so much an intellectual. You get sort of an overall sort of like I get it. I get sort of you understand like, okay, yeah. So I'm getting a feel for this, just in the nick of time, to say the least. That storm in the desert is called Desert Storm. I mean, this reminds me of Desert Storm back in the, what was it, the 2000, early 2000s, right? Desert Storm? Or was that even before that? Again, it's hard to say, right? That might even been before. It was before. That was before. It was like the 1990s, was it not? Desert Storm? That was when Iraq went into Kuwait and tried to take it over, and we came into Kuwait and liberated Kuwait. The U.S. came in, or coalition forces came in, and liberated Kuwait. I think that was Operation Desert Storm. And of course, that was before 9/11. 9/11 led to then the invasion of Iraq and deposing Saddam Hussein, the strong man who was actually holding all the factions together. And now that that's all gone, look what has happened. So Operation Desert Storm, in the dream, big, huge, huge storm. And I felt like if we don't take refuge from this storm, it's going to leave a lasting impression upon us. In other words, we're going to get caught up in the belief that this has made an impression upon God. And this is will then keep us from seeing as God, the way we're supposed to experiencing as God. It will prevent that. In our own mind, we'll think, oh no, we've changed God, we've made an impression. At least that's what we hope. So we'll believe in it. So it's going to really mess up our belief if we get caught up in this. And this is why I saw in the storm, I had to take refuge from this. That the tradition, historical tradition was not strong enough. We need something new and fresh and stronger. We need something stronger. And I was given refuge under this table. And this is a traditional sign of Christianity. Come sup with me, Jesus said. This new table. I'm bringing a new table to dine together. Let's come dine at this new table, right? This is the New Testament. Let's come to this new table and dine here. This is something that is associated with Jesus, because he's talking about the Old Testament was likened to a table where you come dine together. He said, let's dine together at this new table. So I was given this new table to take refuge from this intense desert storm, and it was not able to make an impression upon me. It was not able to make an impression upon me at all. So this means there's going to be a way to take refuge from the what's going to happen in the world. And we don't need specifics. It doesn't matter, you know, detailing it. It's a nasty storm. It's designed to make a lasting impression upon us, thinking we've made a lasting impression on God. So that's his design, and it's going to be nasty. That's all you need to say about it. I don't care how it plays out. It doesn't matter. See, it doesn't really matter at this point. It's going to be nasty. So I stopped watching the news. It doesn't really matter at all who the players are, what their names are, whatever. It's designed. It's the purpose and intent of it. That's all that really matters. And sidestepping that purpose and intent, so it doesn't make us believe that a lasting impression has been made upon God, then we will not see and experience as God, which is our natural functioning. Delighting in everything, and yet nothing leaves this residue or trace in the nothingness of God, the no specificness of God. Shining, God shining as everything and yet remaining as nothing, but concurrently, this is concurrency. And so, you know, you see everything, it's like you see it for the first time. It's not like that you're seeing a memory of it or an impression or a thought of it. You're seeing it exactly, you know, in the freshness of it, that you're seeing it doesn't leave any lasting impression on God at all. And therefore you can say it doesn't leave any impression at all. It's instantly fresh, and God always delivers this perfect freshness, always. No trace or residue is ever present, okay? And maybe people from various traditions will say, yeah, this sounds very similar. Yeah, well, it is. We're all talking about the same. It's all talking about the same situation. We need a fresh table. Very so easy to take refuge in it. So we have this calling card, and you could not give a more extraordinary calling card than this Bunya pine cone. is impossible. B-U-N-Y-A. I wonder, I need to look that up. Nya, what does nya mean? I don't know, maybe this has some spiritual significance. But it's enough to realize that the cultural significance is a very sacred tree, plant, tree, fruit, aboriginal, because it provided these huge festivals of peace. So expect a huge gathering for peace, purposes of peace, true peace, where everyone sets aside their differences and said, hey, this is eternal mind here. And I'm certainly feeling more and more comfortable with eternal mind and getting closer and closer to it. Working with all these graphics of Ramana Maharshi, which I will let you know where I'm going to post those. They're extraordinarily wonderful. Very, very, very powerful. When you spend time working with the picture of Ramana Maharshi, it gets into you. It does. It's, as I said, it's like a spiritual suntan. Same thing, if you want to tan in the world, you got to go outside where the sun is, right? Well, basically, of course, we have artificial tanning, but to just illustrate this point, you go outside, you move around outside, the sun is hitting you, you're going to be tanning. If you want a spiritual tan, you have to be around a spiritual sun, a spiritual source of spiritual light. And just being around that source of spiritual light is enough to start tanning you, like that. Even if you are a little bit confused, don't understand quite as, the tanning is still taking place. Even though, even when you're out in the sun, you're not paying attention to the sun, you're still getting tan. If you're in the presence of some eternal life, the representative of eternal life here in the world, you are going to get a spiritual tan. And I certainly want to get a spiritual tan. There's no question about it. And I bet a lot of you do too. So it has been my intuition that there is going to be at these apocalyptic times and tribulation times representatives of eternal life here, and now I'm seeing, I got a little hint of how they see everything. I said, so that's it. I get it. Wow. Just a little hint, but enough to say, yeah, that's it. It's that simple. Of course they can be here. How extraordinary, and yet how ordinary. The Bunya pine cone. Every time I lift this thing up, I cannot believe, if this hit you on the head, it would kill you. Absolutely. They're told, be careful, don't walk under the Bunya pines. It's unbelievable. I'm a proud possessor of a Bunya pine cone. How many people can say that? Massive calling card. It says a gathering is going to take place. And I know people are getting jittery. I literally know that. People are saying, oh my gosh, I don't know if I can handle it. I don't know if I can keep up with it. Is this too much for me? But it's not. You look at Ramana Maharshi, he's very, so benign. They just kind of say, the guy's okay. And I feel something really nice here. It's nice. It's not so bad. You may not understand anything. But it's going to have a positive effect. You're going to feel like, you know what? I really don't feel like clashing here. And people are clashing right now. This is what I'm aware of. Just generally, I'm not looking at the news or anything because I realize it's go time. But people are clashing. They're getting nervous. People are having breakdowns. And I'm trying to keep everyone's head above water here. It's a lot of stress on me, but I'm doing my best here. So I would say it's on. It's going to happen. It will happen. As I have been trying to prep people for years and years and years and years, saying there will come a time when we will have this great opportunity, and in a world that will seem to be oppressively fearful and hostile to us, etc., dark, cold, contracted, sharp, clashy, all this stuff in a world that seems like we just want to leave it now and forget it. I just want to die, you know, forget it. Suddenly there will come a situation where all of this just seems to be evaporated away, and it will be the sparkling, fresh, clear situation. And I believe this and believed it my whole life, and I'm now more certain than ever that this is what's going to will take place. And people will be quite astonished, because when they're with this situation, it's like the world, all the problems of the world just seem to evaporate. Everything's so beautiful, so wonderful, and so beautiful. Vision of Christ, as Jesus calls it. Vision of Christ. He says, the whole world, you won't believe how gentle and peaceful and beautiful it looks to you. And I believe him. I've always trusted him, but I couldn't quite understand. How do you get this vision? And it's starting, you know, to dawn upon me that this is how it's done. And it will happen. For me, I'd say there's 0% possibility that it won't happen at some point fairly soon. I don't know when, but 0% possibility that it won't happen. It's in other words, 100% that it will, but it's nice to put it and say 0% that it won't happen, because this is what I want to have happen. This is what I've aimed for. And I get it, you know. I've cleared away the confusion, so it's just a matter of when, and I can't predict that at all, really. But certainly, I feel capable of hanging out with some spiritual light, you know, because I trust in it. I trust. I say, you know, they're not just, it's not spiritual babble, you know, it's truth. It's truth. They're telling us true. But don't try to intellectualize it too much, because then you get too frustrated, because you almost think you pinned it down, but it's always somehow elusive. You know, don't try to over-intellectualize the situation. Just continue to believe in it, to prepare, to keep practicing this wow as you hear this. And one of the practices I did today was I just had this gratitude. Say, thank you, God, for what you're about to give me. I am so grateful for this. I know that you're going to give me this vision. And so since I already know this is coming, why not start practicing gratitude for it right now? So immediately this puts me in a mood of gratitude and happy, and I relax. So when we pray, it should be always with gratitude that thank you, God, for what you're about to give me, or give us. You know, thank you so much for, it's going to be more than we possibly could have imagined, actually. And so keep practicing this gratitude instead of saying, well, I'm going to wait and be grateful once it comes. Now, once it comes, then it'll be shocking. And the gratitude might overwhelm you. So it's better to cultivate your expectations. Say, I know it's going to happen. I expect it to happen. I absolutely expect this vision to dawn upon me. And therefore, I might as well start being grateful right now and get used to it. So you can say, I expect this gathering to take place. I expect this opportunity to take place, and start being very grateful to it. Say, wow. You know, I'm so grateful, God, that this is going to happen, and I'm going to be able to benefit from it. So let your emotions, reactions be that which it's a fait accompli. It's an absolute fait accompli, and therefore the smart, safe approach is to start having gratitude for it right now. That puts you way ahead of the game, and you just easily move into it. Whereas those who don't do this will have this whole, you know, steep adjustment curve of gratitude and wow and all this stuff. But if you already ahead of time know, this is going to happen, I'm already experiencing the wow, the gratitude, everything, as if it's already taken place, then when it's here, we'll just easily move into it. This is just, you know, this is, again, spiritual tactics, right? Spiritual tactics, smart spiritual tactics, dealing with our continuity fear in the appropriate way. Yeah, so the crickets are out. this stupefyingly nice day, almost like crystalline, you know, that just, it's so incredible. I cannot explain it. The weather in California has just been putting on a show like you cannot believe. Every day is different. Every day is just like, you know, wow, this is the best day ever. And it may continue on. And we may continue on in it. So, advantages, you're like, you're used to like every day just being like, just about perfect. So in the vision of Christ, seeing as God perceives, perceiving as, well, God doesn't perceive, knows, but it's even better. But the intermediate step is the healed perception. Everything you see every day is perfect. You know, it's just, every day is just absolutely, immaculately delightful, and always. Well, you know, this weather like this is sort of like a precursor. It's a faint way of actually preparing for that. As every day I walk around and just say, my gosh, you know, how, it couldn't possibly be any better. You know, the atmosphere and how everything looks, it's just perfect. In terms of just, you know, sensory, looking at it from a sensory standpoint, but whereas from the standpoint of vision of Christ, is looking at it from a spiritual standpoint, which is unaffected by the weather actually at all. Yeah. So what's the name of that pine cone? The Bunya pine cone. And hopefully someday you'll get to see it. I'm going to keep this pine cone. And so you can all come and, you know, see it at some point. So September 1st, this is, it is officially go time now. And right on that day, isn't this extraordinary? Right on this day, without knowing what would happen at all, I just prayed, I said, God, you've got to do something big today. Really, really, really big. Like, and I also like to tell you, I liken spiritual, the great spiritual teachers, the realizers, the seers, those who see as God, you know, through as God. I liken them to great elephants. And I said to the great elephants, give me a little token of your, that you're coming. And then the Holy Spirit said, no. Elephants don't give little tokens. They give really big, heavy tokens. So I said, if you're coming, you know, great spiritual elephants here, great elephants, send me a big, heavy token, really big, heavy, an elephant-sized token. So what happens? What happens today, September 1st? But, yeah, I'm going to pull a muscle lifting this thing up. A super heavy elephant-sized token shows up here. I mean, only an elephant would give such a token like this, right? I mean, see, the elephants say, no problem, I just lift this up easily. But, so, you know, but isn't that amazing? I'm praying for a really heavy, big, heavy elephant-sized token that they're coming. And here it is. Here it is, here it is, here it is. And a close up of this if you can. Now the lights kinda hit a little bit, but very, very, it's tiring just to do that. It's so heavy. So heavy, 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 heavy.
Oh, gosh.
So the elephants delivered right on cue, right to the day. When something like this happens, you've got to say Holy Spirit. Because the timing of the Holy Spirit is so extraordinary. And it's quite humorous. I mean, who could possibly imagine such a thing happening to them? The Holy Spirit is very humorous. I mean, because where did this come from, you know? I don't know. I think in Google said there's some tree in Sacramento or something, a bunya tree. but there must be one somewhere, you know, in the San Francisco Bay Area somewhere. But what timing and to deliver this right here to me, there's even more of the story. I mean, without giving too much away, but somebody directed me, said, park right here, park right here. There's a guy directing my parking. He said, you pull in right here, right here, right here, right here, right here. Okay. I said, thank you. I said, okay. And I was praying. As I was pulling, I was praying, God, there has to be something right here for me. I absolutely insist upon it. And so I got out of my vehicle. I said, okay, what is there for me? What is there for me? There's got to be something here for me. And then I see this. Is what the heck is that? And I raced over to it. I picked it up and said, this has got to be it. What is this? Didn't even know what it was. But I knew this was it. And now we find out it was the cause of the great gatherings, festivals of the Aboriginal people of Australia, where peace reigns for a long period of time, which is exactly what we need right now. Exactly what we need is people to come out of the intensity of this vicious situation in the world into an atmosphere of where peace reigns, the gentleness, the peace, that which we saw in Rama Maharshi, for example. And you just say, wow, peace reigns here. God is here. Presence of God is here. And the world just seems like a mere trifle to us, a mere silly trifle at this point. You know, the hostility and fear of the world seems like a mere silly trifle, but just all that it really is. Anyway, now the balminess of the air is still happening here. This is unbelievable. You know, it's just amazing. It's really the best run of weather in the history of California since I've been here, 59 years. And we've had 4 years of this, but this summer has been the best run of weather ever. Really, since June 22nd. I mean, just June, July, August, June 22nd to July 22nd, August 22nd. So, you know, it's about, you know, close to 2.5 months of weather. You should make a movie about it, but how can you convey the feeling of the weather in a movie, really? You have to experience it. You know, you can't put it into an image, can you? See, weather is something, the overall atmosphere and the play, you know, where you feel the warmth, but then there's just this air mass of cool, sort of how it's the way it moves, you know, and the gentleness of it. You feel the gentleness of everything, and yet, and the heat, and yet there's also the cool, and all this interplay. And this, you can't convey it in the image, really. You cannot, can you? But if you're here experiencing it, then you know. Then you know. Then you've been graced by it. You've been touched by it. Same thing with a gathering of peace. You're there. You experience it. You know. You've been touched by it. Whereas just an image isn't going to do it. So don't despair. Wherever you are, don't despair. Don't despair. Keep in mind, you think, well, I'm not qualified. I'm not this. I'm not. Are you qualified to sit out in the sun? You know, get a tan? Does the sun ask, hey, are you qualified? No, you walk out in the sun, you get a tan. Anybody can. So it's only a question of doing it. You get a spiritual suntan. You come and you're going to get a spiritual suntan because that's what you want. There might be like a world Kumbh Mela, world spiritual gathering, some sort of gathering where people come from all over the world. And it could happen quite soon actually. It better happen soon. If not, people are going to lose hope. They're going to go crazy. They're going to lose hope. They're going to be tearing at each other's throats. They're going to be like Dionysian initiates, you know, tearing each other limb from limb. So just let this sink in and say, hey, this is really happening. You know, it's almost like a Twilight Zone thing. Is this really happening? Is this all just being made up? No, it's not. All I can say is this is, you don't walk down to Target, you know, and buy a bunya pine cone. It just doesn't happen. And, so. Blessed are those who, you know, have faith and have seen and maintain faith and say, yeah, I have the same feeling. I have this feeling that there's something really great coming in the world. And the nastiness is already here and we can see it's like clouds, you know, dark clouds gathering. And you look up at it and you say, uh-oh. And that's what happened with me. I had the dream that showed me, uh-oh, you know, look up at the sky and say, oh, holy cow, here comes trouble. And then something intuition told me, hey, it's worse than you know. Take shelter immediately. There was this very strong spiritual impression. Take shelter immediately. I was thinking like, well, it looks like it's going to rain pretty soon, you know. And then I got this urgency hit me and said, no, quicker than soon. I mean, it's coming upon us very quickly. Take shelter immediately. Take refuge immediately. And then so I saw this tree and immediately took refuge under this huge eucalyptus tree. And then I realized I needed this table also to keep this desert storm off of me. And then it made no impression upon me. So, this means it's coming very, very quickly, very, very soon. And I've, you know, just shifted gears. It's time to get serious here. So everybody listening to this, it's time to get really serious and say bad habits off the table. That's why I went on this doomsday diet this summer and basically said I'm going to eat anything I want to eat, because I knew there would come a time where, you know, you got to get serious about everything. And said, okay, well, you know, let's enjoy the summer and eat ice cream whenever I ate ice cream whenever I felt like eating ice cream. There's no rules. I just said, if I feel like eating ice cream, I'm going to eat ice cream, period. If I feel like eating cake, cheesecake, any potato chips, whatever, no rules, just eat whatever you want to eat. And of course, I gained a lot of weight, and then I realized, okay, now, you know, did that, been there, done that, thank you, great experience, what a party it was, and now it's time to take refuge from the storm. It was fun. I knew I would gain weight, but I said, what the heck, let's get this done, let's enjoy it, and then now we get down to business here. So I want everyone to just take stock, you know, in their own life right now. We have this little grace period here. And and it's pretty easy. Once you realize it's go time, it's not difficult. I just decided, you know, I wouldn't put myself on a diet for some reason. No. Forget it. And then just one day, just a morning, it was the 30th, I think, August 30th. It was Friday. I think it was maybe August 29th. No, but it was the morning of the 30th. It was August 30th that I started. So that would have been Friday, right? Because today is the second? No, it's the first. So today is Tuesday. So Monday was the 31st. Sunday was the 30th. Saturday. Was the 29th. Okay, so it was the 29th. And yeah, so started in, just said, okay, here, let's just get started. Let's start something here. That's it. No pressure, no forcing, no nothing. I just, yeah, this feels like the right time to start, hit the button, hit the switch. And that's all there was to it. And that's also the, when the news stop looking at it. I've been looking at it this summer a little bit, just to kind of assess the storm. I see the storm going, I say, wow, yeah, it looks pretty bad. And then the Holy Spirit says, it's time. It's time to take refuge now. Don't need to keep looking up at the sky. I'm telling you, take refuge. So I don't even know what from. In specific or detail, don't know what from. Doesn't matter. Doesn't matter. It's going to be it will be severe. We have to take refuge. We're literally trying to make an impression upon God. Literally trying to make an impression upon God by the events that take place here, by the appearances, the dance of appearance. We're trying to make an impression upon God, a lasting impression upon God. It's not possible. Can't do it. And yet we're going to try really, really hard. The world's going to try really hard, and it's going to be, miserable. But we will not be touched by that. Take a refuge. Take refuge. The bunya nut says, "Let's just put is sending out messages from all to all over now." Take refuge. Take refuge. Take refuge. So look for calling cards in your own life. See what the Holy Spirit is doing in your own life. The Holy Spirit is likely to, is going to somehow get your attention, get your attention. Maybe this video is one way of doing that, getting your attention. And look for that, look for that. Don't wait until something happens. Recognize it ahead of time that's on its way, and start practicing gratitude and discipline and all of that. Much more nervous than I should be. I guess this situation gave me really is it's dawning upon me. It must be causing a huge wow reaction in me. Something like this is so amazing. I even it even throws me for a loop a little bit here. I didn't expect to come across this information on this calling card. It's just, almost too much to believe, because it gives an exact parallel, as it were, an analogy to what is to come. Whether this be this gathering, large gathering, people from all over coming in a situation where they put all their differences and squabbles, just put them aside and feast on the good news, the presence. So I may be having trouble with this right now. It seems to be. And we can practice it. Yes, I know it's going to happen, and yes, I know it's not going to happen. Take the pressure off us. Yes, I know. It's going to happen, and yes, I know it's not going to happen. You see, we have to understand that we've been pretending to be mortal mind for so long, we're afraid to stop pretending. We think we'll have no functioning at all. Therefore, we think we still have to accommodate mortal mind in some way to reassure ourselves that we're not going to stop pretending altogether. You know, we're going to pretend that we're eternal mind, essentially, for a little while. And but we need to account for this and reassure ourselves. So we say, yes, I know this is going to happen, meaning we're saying, you know, eternal mind, I know you're coming, thank you. And then we also say, yes, I know this is not going to happen. We're saying, mortal mind, you know, your viewpoint that it's not legit, we're honoring that too. Because mortal mind will look at it and say, this is not legit. And it won't be, it'll explain why not. It'll just say, from my standpoint, immortal mind, I can't go with this. There's something not legitimate. I don't know. You know, they'll make up excuses, rationalize this, project, you know, everything. But it's going to basically say, this just isn't it. There's something better. Immortal mind will say, the ego will say, yeah, this is fine, but it's not really it. There's something better. Yeah. This is how the ego operates. Whatever it is, if it's, you know, true of spirit, ego tends to say, well, that's nice spirit, but, you know, I have something better. So to honor this fear of that mortal mind, which is really are just pretending to be mortal mind, but because of the continuity fear and fear of lack of ending our pretending, we don't want to end our pretending. This will stress us out too much. So we say, yes, I know this is really going to happen. Yes, I know this is not really going to happen. I mean, it satisfies both our, you know, alignment with eternal mind and our habit in our pretending, habit of pretending as mortal mind. It satisfies both positions. And it seems like an accord has been reached within us, you know, like a peace treaty, an armistice. Like there's an armistice within us, an internal armistice saying, okay, we're going to set aside our differences between mortal mind and eternal mind for a little while. And we'll say, yeah, this is really it. And yes, I know this is really it. And yes, I know this isn't really it. Or yes, I know this is all that I can handle right now. And yes, I know this isn't all that I can handle right now. To, you know, please both sides. Please both sides by saying this. And this brings about an armistice. So yeah, just you have to handle the wow of this. So we back off a little on the pressure of this. Now, do we know specifics? No, don't need to know specifics. The news is so good, general is plenty. It's plenty to have the general outlines of it. It's the ego that always wants specifics. Thinking that just throwing a bunch of specifics will make its situation better, even though it's not. But we know, wow, the situation's so great. It's like if you're experiencing a great day like today, do you really need to know exactly the temperature or the wind velocity or the barometric pressure? Really? I mean, you can't enjoy the day without knowing exactly these things? That's ridiculous, of course. But the ego will say, well, you don't know what the barometric pressure is. How can you be enjoying the day? It's nonsense. You know, you'd be a lot better off if you check the barometric pressure. Of course, when you're doing that, you're not really enjoying the day. You're not really, you know, you got yourself worried like, well, I can't enjoy it until I know what the barometric pressure is. This is, of course, absurd. It's silly. And so also, you know, it's like, okay, so this has happened now. What's next? You know, what's next? What is next? Either for me, this is the pressure I'm under, is the desire for asking for a calling card. Holy cow! Holy Spirit answered. And so now I say, oh, wow. what's going to be next. Maybe the Maharaj. Now, I know I said I was going to put off all reactions till October. Well, I better start trying to practice that better. Because I'm having such a strong reaction, I need to just say, okay, I'm not going to react. Well, maybe this is a calling card. Maybe it isn't. Obviously, this is a calling card. Obviously, it isn't. You know, and try to diffuse the reaction here and push it into October. Doesn't seem to be working, so we'll have to come up with the right tactic here. Too much internal tension. So this is on, you know. We don't need to pay attention to what's going on in the world specifically. Doesn't matter. We know it's the apocalypse. The intensity is on. And so I'm saying to whoever will listen, it's go time now. It's absolutely go time. September 1st. I've been saying this and saying this and saying this. September 1st is going to be go. It will be go time. And here we are. We're off and running. Off and running. So try to keep your... What's that? Some animal just somehow came in from somewhere. I think roosting. I don't know. It's interesting. Keep the content of your experiencing now very spiritual. Start to get into it. Start to get into it now. That's why I've been making these videos and posting them here. Some of the graphics I've been doing. You know, start to get in the mood. Get in the mood. Get in the mood. Put yourself in the mood. Start like a spiritual exercise. Start doing spiritual exercises like this. For instance, that video with Course in Miracles, lessons scrolled from 0 to 300. Of course, some of the lessons are repeated in review periods. So there's not actually 300. There's like 200 and... something, 12 or whatever of them. You know, go through the video and just, you know, read every single lesson. You know, just like a spiritual suntan. Start working on your tan. Work on your pre-tan. You know, work on your pre-tan. Once you get a nice pre-tan, it'd be a lot easier than to get the, you know, the full intensity and then get a real great glowing spiritual tan, which we most certainly will get a very glowing, golden glowing spiritual tan. People might ask you, well, you like this golden glow? Yeah, this glow, like a golden glow. Well, that's just, you know, it's just my spiritual tan is all. That's what you're feeling. How'd you get the tan? Well, you got to hang out with where the spiritual sun is, of course. The sun, inner sun, the true light of God. Which is actually what everything, what all is. We're just trying to make an impression upon it, a lasting impression, and can't do that. And we're believing that we know a way. So we're in order to believe that there's a way, we obviously have to believe that somehow God isn't really God. Because if we experience God, we'd know there is no way. It would be obvious to us. So we refuse to experience the nature of God. We refuse. Put all these defenses against it. Instead, don't cling to fear. Now, I do have, you know, a Twitter site. I have only 3 followers on Twitter. I have the link below this video in every video I put up. I try to, almost every video. I need to, a couple of them I've done recently have not, but I have the link to Twitter, which will give you announcements of what's going on. I also, Facebook, I have a link to Facebook page. You know, nobody's made any overtures to, you know, to go to that page. Have a blog where I also post messages of what's going on. I post like the artwork, the graphics that I've been working on, and you can, you know, find that stuff and start getting this pre-tan. This is what, you know, I know it's coming. This is why I've been doing all this work. So you can get a pre-tan. Work on your pre-tan, and it will be great for you, because then you'll feel, oh, it's not so difficult. I know I can handle this. I know I already have a pre-tan, you know. For example, if someone like Ram Maharshi was here in the world, you'd say, well, I already have at least a pre-tan, and so I feel it's a lot. Oh, I'd be able to handle this, you know. It's going to be more intense, but I'm ready for it now. This is how I see it. This is why I'm doing this, is make sure I have a pre-tan. So I've been trying to put up, you know, as many beautiful graphics and that's expressive, evocative of the spiritual attitude and feeling and presence. It's a pre-tan. It's not the real thing, of course, but it's, the idea is kind of like, think of it as a pre-tan. So at least you feel, okay, this might, it's like maybe putting a tanning lotion on. You say, oh, look at that, I've got this, it looks like I'm tan. So at least you feel like, well, I know what it looks like to be tan, but this isn't the real tan, but I kind of have a pre-idea, it's like a pre-tan. Look at it that way, like a pre-tan, okay? And we know this. I mean, it's like the presence of eternal life. You know, not, won't necessarily have to say anything. We're not worried about asking questions. It's like a tan. We know we're going to get a tan. Just hang out there, and we'll feel it and say, "Wow, I can feel it. I can really feel it." It's like my spirit is been radiating. My spirit, like the sun hits our, when the sun hits our skin, we can feel it. You know, basking in the sun, we can feel it. So, and we know we're being slowly roasted and getting a tan. Well, it's the same thing. It's similar, getting a spiritual tan. We'll feel, oh, I'm just being roasted here, very gently roasted, and we're experiencing it. Brahma Maharshi didn't have to say anything. People would come and just sit down, and immediately they'd say, wow, I'm feeling something that's just extraordinary. Feeling this extraordinary peace, this, you know, it's just like being, I'm just basking in it, like basking in a sun. They didn't have to say anything or ask any questions at all. Just be there. So, this is how it really works here in the world. This, you know, I've been very much clued into all of this. So I would say, amazingly enough, this whole situation, you can say it got started on the 1st of September. That this unmistakable calling card is part of the beginning of it all. And of course, we're taking the safe route. We're taking refuge. We're not going to gamble on what's going on in the world. We're going to say, look, world, I trust in you. I trust in my own projections that, you know, we have projected all this upon you. Our intent of all, you know, intent of what we're trying to do. I trust that this is what it's, you know, what the purpose and intent of the world is. So I'm knowing and trusting in that. I'm going to also know I need to take refuge from it, for sure. Absolutely. And many, 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 many signs have been shown to me that this is what is necessary. Oh, I forgot. Amazing. Today, a situation without giving too much away about the people involved, but just there was this tire, and it was noticed and was taken off this vehicle. Thank God, just in time. And this tire on the inner part of the tire, towards the vehicle, not the outer part of the tire that's exposed to the road, but the inner part of the vehicle, which is underneath the vehicles of the tire, that part, had this terrible, terrible bubble in the sidewall, like a balloon ballooning out. And it's, oh my gosh, you just touch it like this, and that tire's going to blow out. That tire is going to blow out, was going to blow out any time. It was going to blow out, for sure. And they caught it just in time. Amazingly so. Grace of God, that was noticed. Because most people, how often do you look at the inside, inner sidewall of your tire? You know, never. I never have done that. But this was, someone looked at this vehicle, caught it, and changed the tire. Otherwise, it would have blown out on them and then maybe killed them and others. You know, very bad situation. The world is like this tire. The world is like this tire. We've been putting pressure on it, pressure on it, pressure on it, pressure on it. And it's ready to blow out. At any moment, we could have a blowout in the world. Just like a tire blows out, you're driving along, boom! You know, it goes flat in an instant. It can throw you off the road. It can cause great, great problems. This is what the Holy Spirit's showing me. The world is ready to have a blowout. But as long as it doesn't blow out, you travel on the road, you feel fine. You say, everything's great. I'm going to, you know, fast on the freeway. I'm getting to where I want to go. Life's cabaret is wonderful. I had that happen to me once. And then suddenly, boom! And your whole world changes just like that. Shocking. Shocks you. And hopefully you can keep control of the car, but blowouts have been known to cause all sorts of problems. In fact, people I know have been having blowouts. It's a real attention getter. So this was shown as an extreme attention getter. The world is about to have a blowout. Just like a tire develops a weak spot in the sidewall and it starts ballooning out. So, with all the pressure this world is under, and the world is so tired and so aged, like an ancient, weak tire, the sidewall is bulging out, and it's ready to have a blowout somewhere. So, any day, this blowout could happen. So, but we're not going to watch the news to see what might be this. We're just going to have faith, hey, it's going to happen. So, it doesn't matter what day it is, and it doesn't make any difference. It could be this day or that day. It doesn't matter how severe it could be or this. It's a blowout is a blowout. And when it has to do with the world, it's not going to be pretty at all. So we're just taking, at this point, we're just taking refuge as fast as we can. That's all there is to it. That's the bottom line. And the Holy Spirit is helped me provide materials for whoever wants them. We'll see. I might just do a blowout with that too, and just do a huge dump of everything. I don't know. We'll see. Yeah. What was that? There's something else. Oh, yeah. Someone told me something else. Very, very extraordinary. Gosh. I can't give it away, you know, the people away and exactly how it was. But it exactly corroborated what I have been said in many videos, that the ego, which is working through the collective cosmic corporate culture, which works through the corporate media and entertainment, its goal always, as it takes over a world, seduces a world, takes it over, it approaches Eve and says, Eve, it's the females on the planet, and says, you're superior to the men. They're just jealous of you. That's why they try to, quote unquote, control you. You know, the male ego, you know, feels insecure, and you don't have the problems. It's the men that have the continuity problem and the bad habits. You don't suffer from that. You know, you're able to multitask, and you can just flick a switch whenever you want to. You don't have that trouble. And by seducing this female psyche this way, then they're able to put females in control, which is what they've wanted to do, and double down on the ego position that there is, you know, continuity, fear, no, we got it covered, don't worry, that's only a man problem, it's not our problem. And then the women become vastly overconfident in themselves, but in the ones in positions of power, you know, they feel like, oh, I mean, I just can handle this naturally. It's not going to be a problem for me at all. Training? I don't need training. Background? I don't need background. That's for men. That's because they have bad habits and a continuity problem. But me, I don't have bad habits. I don't have a continuity problem. Whatever I need, I just flick a switch and problem solved. So you get this gynocracy, as I say, and they're going to mess it up big time. They're incompetent. You know, plain and simple. I mean, I've heard people tell me, they said, good God, the women think they know everything. And they're so confident. Why are they so confident? Because they think they don't have a problem with a continuity problem. In whatever situation they're in, they think it's just a matter of, I can just decide that it's going to be right, and continuity problem won't affect me. I'll get it right every time. No problem for me. And so they're never wrong. Never wrong. Being wrong can't happen to the ego as a woman. It can't happen. And so they bought into this. And so they're in tremendous positions of power to control the narrative of this planet. And what happened was, I can't give it away exactly, but some female did something that hurt this man just out of sheer incompetence. And he said, it's just like, unbelievable how she could have done that. It's just bizarre. But it happened. She had no business doing what she was doing. She was incompetent, but yet she was out there pretending like, oh yeah, sure, I can do this. Not a problem. Not a problem for me. And it was a big problem. It was a big problem. You know, I mean, this is the situation in the world where you have men that maybe come from, you know, generation after generation of diplomats or something, and it's in their blood. I mean, they're so accustomed to it, and they've studied so hard, and they, you know, they're really good at it. And the female come and say, "Hey, move aside. My natural feminine qualities will be way better than anything you can do." So yeah, but what about all your training and you know, having long history of how to deal with very delicate? No, not to worry. I'm woman. Hear me roar. You know, I can take care of this. No problem. It's just yeah, but what about, you know, the continuity? You know, the issue. Yeah, you're just jealous. You're just jealous. Move aside, boys. It's time for mom to take over. It's time for the experts to take over. Experts? Well, where'd you get your expertise? It's natural. It's that you don't understand. You're a guy, you don't understand. We have this natural ability. It's just all natural. So this is the mentality that has given rise to the present situation where what's going to cause this blowout, and it's going to hurt real, real bad. And I've been saying this for so long. It's not just something recently. I've been trying to point this out to the world. Basically, my whole life, I said, hey, this is going to happen. It's going to happen. And you get these women who are just totally in over their head and incompetent at to the level of where they're functioning. They're incompetent at that level, and yet they think that they're just like the greatest thing that ever happened to the world. And you cannot say anything otherwise to them. They'll say you're just sexist. You know, that's all there is to it. You know, move aside, boys. We got it covered. Don't worry. We know exactly what we're doing. Unlike you, you know, who've messed everything up. And then they will proceed to mess things up beyond anything that we could possibly imagine. Because we're still going on the paradigm of male management in the world. Except we say, well, you know, bad stuff could happen, but I think, you know, we can try to minimize it in this way, and we kind of know what to expect, et cetera, et cetera. But now we don't know what to expect. You know, we really don't know the kind of gaffes that these female leaders, et cetera, are in positions of high bureaucratic power. So we don't know what they're going to do in the media, et cetera, how they're going to spin the narrative. It's going into uncharted territory, and it's going to be very, very painful. But this is what the ego wants. It's what the ego wants. The ego wants to try to make an impression on God. So it wants to mess things up real bad. And I know there's been a ton of men and women saying, whoa, whoa, not so fast. This, you know, this is, you're going down a very slippery slope. You're going way too fast, way overconfident. This, we're throwing away all our checks and balances, all our safeguards, you know, all this stuff. This is not good at all. So what's worse, to have, you know, two angry, belligerent men or two overconfident women? It's two overconfident women. It's a lot worse. Because angry, belligerent men, they'll say, huh, I'm really angry and belligerent with you, but you're really angry and belligerent with me. And this could get bad, you know. Why don't we have a temporary armistice here and an accord, and let's think about this for a while. That's how it happens. You know, they understand the consequences. Whereas though two overconfident women will say, eh, no problem, guys, I got it covered. You know, I'm flawless. I can't make any mistakes. I'm naturally just born this way. You know, I mean, females automatically can handle anything much better than men can handle anything. This has been the radical feminist propaganda, brainwashing of women for the last 50 years, at least 50 years. I say 55 years, actually. Yeah. This is what it's been. This has been very explicit that, you know, we just, you know, the guys are just jealous. They don't really know their screw-ups. They don't know how to do it. But we will just do, like, such an incredibly better job. You can't even imagine how much greater it's going to be. And anybody that dare just taking refuge, what an insult to us. How sexist can that be? You know, that's a just terrible sexist insult to think that we can't handle things perfectly. What are they, you know? So this is the trouble. You know, we're thinking like, oh gosh, how guilty I am to take refuge at, you know, in this and generational thing too. The millennials think they got it all covered. You know, they got it all. They're overconfident too. Millennials are very overconfident because, oh, they got technology, we got computers. What are you guys worried about? We didn't have computers before. That's why we had the wars and the conflict. It wasn't because of the ego and are trying to change God. That has nothing to do with it, they say. It's because you didn't have the right technology. Now that we have the right technology, peace and love is on its way, folks. No doubt about it. So I find the millennials to be extremely overconfident. You know, reckless. Reckless, 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 reckless. In fact, someone just mentioned that to me, that they're very reckless. Wow. Amazing. I spoke with a millennial recently, and they told me that, yeah, they have a lot of good qualities, but they're extremely reckless. Holy cow. So you get a combination of radical feminists leading the millennials, and you're talking about extreme recklessness, extreme overconfidence, extreme recklessness. I'm the opposite. I want to take the safe way. Let's find the safe way. Let's be humble. Let's be confident, but humble. Let's find the safe way, and let's take the safe way. You know, so, hey, they can say what they want. We're taking refuge, plain and simple. Like I said before, King Solomon, that was his say, there's nothing more dangerous than nothing worse than a certain type of woman. When she, you know, which is true. He said that's the most dangerous, terrible thing possible. Which is the situation we're in right now. I mean, you know, a radical feminist would rather pluck some woman off, random woman off the street and make her president than choose the most qualified man possible, someone who's been groomed for generations back, you know, who understands the game at so many different levels. who's able to multitask this chess game, so beautifully. And the radical feminists say, no, the random woman off the street would be way superior than this man. That is their belief. It's deeply entrenched within them. And of course, it's just extremely dangerous belief system. It's the ego. If the ego says, no, we can do better than that. Peace, the ego says, nah, we can do a lot better than that. Bliss, that's fine, but we're way better than that. We can bring conflict. So the ego always tries to put us into an idealized image of something that can be attacked, and the ego can cause severe conflict within that, because that's what it wants. It wants to make an impression upon God through what? Through conflict. Through fear. Through attack. And it wants to remove the safeguards to fear, conflict, and attack. It wants to remove the safeguards, and there have been many wise women and men in this world who have been vigorously protesting the removal of these safeguards. All right? Women just as much as men. Both vigorously protesting this for the last 60 years, saying this is wrong. Do not remove all these safeguards in the world. You're saying, it's great. I mean, these tech people are, like I said, they're Stone Age people. They're living in a Stone Age. They're not advanced. They're super regressed. It reminds you like the hippies were wearing Indian beads or something and thinking like, we're so awesome. I got these, smartphone, I'm so awesome. No, you're not. You're a cave person. Because you're completely unaware of mental, spiritual technology. Those who are unaware of spiritual technology are cave dwellers, living in a stone age. And they try to compensate from it. Yeah, they say, well, we don't need the eternal life. We don't need the representatives of eternal life. What do we need that for? We've got Apple Pay. I can go here and get some groceries and use Apple Pay. My God, it's unbelievable. I mean, look how advanced we are. Holy cow. I mean, eternal life, who needs it? Who needs it? Look, we got Apple Pay. I got an iPhone. I don't need to sit in the presence of the spiritual light, of eternal life. And get a spiritual tan. What the heck is that for? I've got an iPhone. I don't need that stuff. I've got an iPad. I've got iTunes. These people going through eternal life, what a bunch of idiots. I mean, I've got something way better than that, I've got an iPhone. I can take pictures with my iPhone. These are Stone Age. Stone Age cave dwellers. And I'm not joking at all. I'm absolutely serious about this. These people are Stone Age cave dwellers. Extreme fools. Extreme fools. Again, they say, we don't need to go to any gathering where the presence of eternal life is radiating its grace upon us. We're out taking pictures with our iPhones and using Apple Pay. To pay, to buy something. We're way more advanced than those people, way more advanced. This is the folly of this generation, the tech generation, the extreme folly, not only of them, but those who also believe this way. I can go to a baseball game and spend all the time texting, which a lot of people do. And, they say, I don't need any more cool. This is like the ultimate in cool. I don't need to go see to a gathering of eternal life. I'm sitting in a game texting. And this is what they believe, which is, sheer arrogant folly. So, they're living in a stone age, a gilded stone age. And those are the unfortunate ones. So the ego's playing, for fools. And the ego will use them to try to make an impression upon God, which is impossible. And yet the attempts can be quite vigorous and vicious to do this. Yeah, so that's why I said that stop, drew the line. I'll use a cell phone. I don't even like using that, but I'll use a cell phone. Use this simple computer here. And keep it simple, but draw the line on anything else. Stay away from the Stone Age. Stay away from the Stone Age. They're truly extreme fools, this tech generation. Extreme fools. Reckless fools. Reckless fools. Fools are often very reckless. It's like someone, you know, gets their car and they're 18 or something, and got a brand new car, fast car. They say, "Wow, I'm so cool." You know, they're so reckless, they don't really understand what's going on. They go to a party, they drink too much, and they get in the car and they say, "Hey," you know, they're going 130 miles an hour or something like that. And of course they crash, you know, idiots. But they think that they're superior. They're invincible. They know better than everyone. This immaturity, you know, we know best. We know better than anyone. It's immaturity. So this is what the problem is, that the world is being run by very immature people right now, and their constituency is extremely immature, way overvaluing their maturity, very reckless, very foolishly reckless, Stone Age, gilded Stone Age, sophisticated savages. Gaudy barbarians. Very much so barbarians. And you'll be able to notice, you start seeing these people, you know, I've got my iPhone just all the time on their iPhone. It's like, I'm so cool. And you just look at them and you say, wow, they're just like, you can tell everything they do is like barbaric. They're barbarians. They're not graced with eternal life, with the awareness to focus on eternal life at all. Not that someone who is does everything gracefully necessary. No, I mean, we got rough spots, rough edges, rough times, etc. But there's a quality, you know, that's different. It's just like, hey, let me not try to impress mortal mind. Let me not be impressed by mortal mind. I'm not really that impressed by mortal mind at all. It's silly. This stuff is very silly. I felt it this morning. I don't want anything more to do with technology. What a joke it is. I just realized it. What a joke it is. It's our excuse to ignore eternal mind. What you know, any excuse to ignore eternal mind is a joke. That's all that it is a joke. It's so stupid, it's just a joke. It's a stupid joke. And so let's take it as a stupid joke. And, you know, a stupid joke's really not that funny. You kind of, yeah, okay. It's not even a good joke. It's a stupid joke. Kind of might smile. Just kind of go, yeah, okay. Stupid joke. It's like a termite walks into the bar and asks the bar, hey, where's it? Asks the guy, bartender, hey, where's the bartender? Comes and says, hey, where's the bartender? Oh, okay, yeah, funny. Termite walks in the bar, where's the bartender? Oh, you're great. That reminds me of another person who walked into a bar. Actually, it doesn't. It doesn't remind me. A rabbi, a pastor, and a priest were sitting in a bar. Yeah. And, okay. Yeah. That's all you need to say. That's funnier than the joke. So practice gratitude ahead of time here. Practice gratitude ahead of time. Our ship is coming in. It's given us this heavyweight calling card. There's no doubt about it now. There are many, 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 many other indications before, so many. But now it's left this heavy, heavyweight, concrete calling card of this bunya, pine cone, exotic pine cone, to say the least. And we know, okay, the ship is coming in. It's like the ship is so near that they're able to toss stuff off the ship. You know, the people on the ship say, "Hey, people on the shore, here we are. Here's some favors we're throwing to you from the ship." And like, you know, that's how close the ship is. They can toss stuff to shore. Pre-tan. That's the order of the day. Get your pre-tan on. Forget the news if you can. You know, you can't do both really well. This is the thing. If you try to do two things really well right now, you're going to fail. Just try and do one thing really well, which is work on this pre-tan. Do that really well, and this will put you in an excellent, excellent position. It's a great discipline to have right now. Come what may, it's using your time, you know, in the wisest way. But we expect that the situation is going to get better and better and better and better and better for us. So pre-tan is very helpful. All right, let's go do it. Expect some surprise videos. Those of you who are still with this, expect some surprise videos. They're just like, hey, this is kind of cool. This is a little different. This is cool. You never know what to expect here, do you? Actually, you don't. Expect the unexpected. Very great. That's it for this one.